what brings you here today?
It's the better broader understanding of it. I practice Kriya Yoga and I meditate most mornings and evenings. Yeah, I just wanted to hear from someone else with their experiences.
Meditation affected your life?
It gives you a more holistic view of the issues. It allows you to get a better understanding of yourself and develop more of a purpose in your life, what you're doing, how you approach it. It generally makes everything better, happier as well. It's good for us. Put your hand up if you've never been to a Chi Kri event where Neil has conducted something before. Wow. You're in for an absolutely special treatment. Those of us who have been before, we know why we're here, but thank you for making the time. Your time will be very well rewarded. My name is Mehul Shah. I'm a Chi Kri yoga teacher. I have been practicing yoga for a number of years, and I have attended yoga classes given by well over hundreds of yoga teachers. And Neil just said to me a few minutes ago, he said, can you just talk a little bit about what made you choose Chi Kri? You have experienced yoga given by many other teachers. And I'll tell you what it is. I had to sit down and think a little bit, but I tell you what it is. Number one, Neil has such a fantastic understanding of what yoga and life is all about. His understanding about the metaphysical laws that govern this universe, why we are here, how we came about, what our purpose in life is, it goes to such depths, it's unbelievable. And yet, he's got a way of being able to explain this in a way that everybody can understand. Now that is a rare gift, to A, understand something really complex and then put it in a way that seems so simple for everybody to understand that you and I and everybody can connect with what he's saying. You will see what I mean in a minute. The other thing though is that I've realized that he's inspired me to bring out not only what I would believe to be my best, but better than my best all the time, from day one. From day one, and he'll do the same for you. He'll make you believe not only that there are no ceilings, no limits to what you can achieve, but you'll find yourself being inspired to become a best person, the best version of who you are. Day in and day out, constantly. Every time I meet him, I come away being inspired to say, okay, I need to do a little bit more now. Grow in this direction, grow in that direction. You can't put a price onto that. That's what draws me to Chi Kri time and again, time and again. And any one of these Chi Kri teachers here will tell you exactly the same thing. This is why we're Chi Kri. Now I'm going to hand over to Neil in a minute. Neil Patel has got a huge lineage of yoga. His mother, Tara Patel, was a yoga teacher as well. Neil has effectively been around the yoga scene from the time he was a little child. He's used yoga, primarily yoga, to overcome cancer that he still lives with, but to overcome cancer where the doctors have given up on him. That's the power of his mind. So you're seeing somebody very, very unique and special here today. And it is a real privilege to be able to receive some of the teachings. I'm now going to hand over to him. He's going to talk about meditation. And I'll hand over to him.
Thank you, Mehul. Thank you, Mehul. Can you all hear me okay?
Yes.
Everyone in the back, can you hear me?
Yes.
Cool. Is it okay if I sit down for a few moments? And then Stan, can you all see me?
Yes.
Can you all feel me?
Yeah.
No. We're going to work harder at that bit, right? Before I get to standing, I'll just give you a little bit of a background on me, in addition to what Mehul was saying. Yes, I've been teaching yoga for a number of years, 26 years now. I started teaching in 1990. Sorry if some of you have heard all this before a few times. I started teaching in 1990 to a yoga teaching mother. The story goes that she used to have a job as a secretary, working day to day outside, and me as a young 4-year-old wanted my mother to be at home. So I insisted that she changed her job, and she didn't know what else to do to be at home most of the time, so she started teaching yoga. Put an advert in the paper, she didn't know anything about yoga, and wasn't not even trained. Put an advert, I'm gonna teach yoga, she started teaching yoga, and I was happy because my mother was at home every time I came home from school. So that's how I got yoga into my life, and then I followed her into the path of Yogananda, our guru, our family guru, and started getting a bit more deeper into yoga. And then when I started doing more yoga and growing up in this country, I realized it couldn't be done the traditional way and it had to be changed a little bit. So I started my own organization in 1990 called Chikra Yoga, which would embody things like hip hop music, things like poetry, things like diet, which was very popular in the UK in the 1990s and obviously now. And also metaphysics, the science of life, incorporating that with traditional classical yoga of asana, pratyahara, pranayama, meditation, and all of those things to combine it into a new format. And that became Chikra Yoga. So that's it, it's a pretty boring story. It's how I got here today, and I continue to do what I do, and I'm happy doing that. So where it became interesting was when God said to me, or the universe said to me, or life said to me in the year 2000, okay, big mouth, you think you know a bit about yoga? I'm going to give you cancer and see if you can put your money where your mouth is. You talk about all this spiritual stuff and God, let me see you live with cancer. So I got this challenge and it was a sarcoma. I'm just going to talk 5 minutes about this. There's a sarcoma in my left leg, and ordinarily the doctors tell you you live for 1 year if you don't take chemotherapy, radiotherapy and surgery. I disagreed with that. I said, in my own head, God is my cure. And I say to you all now, quite happily, and you can take my lawyer's number down later if you want to contact him, but God can cure cancer. So sue me. Okay? So in myself, I said, you know what? Soul over cells. My soul, my Atman, is more powerful than any cell in the body. My soul created my cells. So my soul will do what it wants to do in my cells. And no doctor on this planet is going to tell me when I'm going to die. So I refused chemotherapy, I refused surgery, and I refused radiotherapy. The tumor at that time was grade 3, and it was 12 centimeters big. I'm hanging out with it still. It's 24 centimeters big now. It's one of my best mates. Sits in my pocket with me all day, goes everywhere I go. His name's Eric. Say hello to Eric. Say hi to Eric. Not a problem, not a problem. You know why? Because I meditate every day. I have the power of God inside me. Nothing makes me afraid, especially cancer. To me, cancer is like having a cold. Or you break an arm. Everyone has afflictions in life. Some people are deaf. Some people lose a leg. Some people have a tumor. But they make a shitload of money out of cancer patients in this country and in America. It's a $1 billion industry. They are killing us to make money. And again, you can speak to me about my lawyer and contact him. I don't care. I'm here to tell you the truth. The truth is we can fix ourselves of anything we go through in our life, anything. But we've been stripped of our spirituality by the money merchants. Because they want you to park your body into their laboratory, into their hospital, and then charge you money, get the money subsidized from the government, and make money and walk out. Meanwhile, cancer, in the 1940s, 1 in 30 people got it. Now, they're saying by 2020, it'll be 1 in 2. But still, they're peddling the same drugs. And in 1939, they had an act passed through Parliament called the 1939 Cancer Act. And it outlawed anybody from healing anybody with cancer unless it was chemo, radio, or surgery. They've already kicked Ayurveda, our national heritage of medicine, out of the UK, that no one can bring medicine, so Ayurveda in the UK. They'll do it with everything that cures cancer. One of the greatest doctors was Dr. Gerson. He found a cure for cancer through juicing. He was kicked out by the FDA, out of America into Mexico. As soon as you find a cure for cancer, they'll kick you out. So that's why I don't care anymore. They can put me in jail, they can sue me for what I've got. God will cure your cancer. He cured mine. So anyway, my story, I've lived now 16 years, meditation every day. I invite the Spirit of God inside me, the power of my soul, and nothing touches me. They said, one doctor said to me, a medical doctor said, you've got the hand of God on you. Another said, you're a miracle man. Another one said, you defied all medical logic. All the same doctors who said you will die. So what is this? It's fear. And this is one of the spiritual diseases that we have in our society, is we get too afraid by things. You know? We get too afraid. We don't know how powerful we are. We do not realize how powerful. We follow adverts, marketing, doctors, and all this, but we don't follow the truth of who we are inside. We are monsters. We are so powerful. And I'll tell you later on in the talk today, a part of every single one of us is God. There is a part of us that is connected to God all the time. One part of us in our seventh chakra, in our crown chakra, is constantly connected to God. Constantly. And if you were but to just tap onto this power, nothing is beyond your reach. No death can scare you, no cancer can kill you. That is the truth. But the problem is, they can't patent it, synthesize it, and sell it back to your ass. I'm sorry, I'm going to be straight. I am who I am. That's the reason why they don't go around saying, yes, you know what, yoga can help you cure diseases. I'm on the board at Parliament and the House of Commons and the House of Lords about getting yoga through to schools and on the NHS. I take part in all these meetings with members of the House of Lords and very important people. And why it gets stopped at the edges? Because they know how powerful it is that yoga and meditation can actually do something. How did India survive all these many, many years? On the power of the Vedas, on the scriptures that talked of yoga, that talked of Ayurveda, that talked of aircrafts before we even discovered what they were. They've got thousands of years of history of surgical equipment before we even discovered surgery in this country. India has all the, and I'm sorry, I'm completely pro-India, I'm pro the Vedic region, I'm pro it all totally, but what India has to offer the world is incredible. I will say this to you today. Yoga and meditation will save this planet. When yoga and meditation spreads, and not the Hindu yoga, not that everyone has to be a yogi of the Indian type. No, the pure science of yoga is the only thing that will save this planet. When people find their temples inside their souls, instead of looking them for temples outside, when people see their wealth in making people happy, instead of their wealth in their bank account, when people unify, because the word yoga means union, when they start unifying with each other, then the world will be happy. Now, one main reason why yoga is so powerful in meditation, because it gives you peace inside yourself. One of the main problems with people today, they don't have peace. The simplest of things. And when you don't have peace, you get jealous of other people's peace, you want to destroy people's peace, you want to destroy things because you're not happy. Now imagine if everybody was peaceful inside. What are they going to do? If everyone's wealth was inside them, they don't need to cause any trouble. Yoga is the path that leads you to your inner wealth. Meditation is the road you take. And that's what I'm here to talk to you about today. But I'm putting it right up here to tell you my story, just to tell you today, I risk my life on my words. I'm putting my money where my mouth is. I got cancer, I still have it today, and I'm not scared. If you tomorrow, you go ask yourself this question. If tomorrow, and I hope none of you do get this, and I hope any of you who have got cancer today are as strong as I am, but you go ask yourself, someone gave you a year to live, what are you going to do? I pray that all of you found power in yourself. And I hope that today gives you a little bit of a spark towards that. Because my friends, all the power is inside you. All the power is inside you. There is nothing you need to look for. You have everything. So, I'll tell you a little bit, the next note that I have down is what is real yoga. First thing, yoga has nothing to do with the body. It's like describing the internet as Ethernet cables. Describing the entire internet as Ethernet cables. That's like describing yoga as asana. It has nothing to do with the body. Okay? The word yoga means union. Union of what? Union of the soul and the spirit. So anyone who's practicing yoga that doesn't understand that, I don't know what you're doing with your day when you go to yoga class, because you're not doing yoga. And if you understand that it's the connection between this power that I'm talking about inside you with the great power of spirit, that is yoga, union. Okay? So, you go and you practice your yoga postures, it's fine. That's to enable you to sit on the mat and meditate. That's the only reason that they've done yoga postures. Is my mic okay? You're hearing me all right at the back?
Yes.
That's the only reason that they do yoga postures, is to keep your body fit enough to sit tall, to meditate, and to not have annoying health problems every now and then. But that's it. To describe yoga as that is wrong. It's not that. Like I said, it's like describing the entire internet as the Ethernet cable. There's one little physical part of it, and it's meaningless, also go wireless. Okay? So that's what yoga is, and don't forget. The other thing I'll tell you about what yoga is, yoga, the word yoga means union. In traditional Sanskrit, it means union. I say, and at Chikri, we say yoga is love. The purpose of yoga was to unite the soul back to the spirit. Now, because we can't find the spirit, because we're in this Maya, this creation, we find it in each other, or we find it in things. And all these things, like each other, they contain souls. So we're attracted to other souls. And we call that love. But what you're actually practicing is yoga. So every time you love something, it's unifying. The word yoga means unify. Every time you love, you unify. It's the same thing. Love is the magnetic power that draws God back to God. Love is the magnetic power that draws souls back to souls. We're all fragmented from this great Brahma that broke himself up into many parts, and we're coming back together. Every time we come back together, it's called love. But love is union, is yoga. Yoga is love, is union. It's the same principle. So where there is yoga, there should be love. Where there is yoga, there should be a connection to the spirit. Anything else is lesser than this conversation we're having today, and is not right. So when you think about your yoga, that's how I want you to think of it. Another word that some of you may be aware of, can these people see the seats at the back? Their spaces at the back. It's the word samadhi. Who knows the word samadhi? Have you heard of it? Some of you put your hand up if you know, have you heard the word samadhi? So, good. So you probably know what I'm going to say now. Samadhi is the final result of the path of meditation, where one is trying to take their soul back to meet the spirit, and when the soul meets the spirit, it meets in the joy of the fulfillment of the unrequited love that's gone on for centuries, and it's an ecstatic moment where the soul meets the spirit again, and that's samadhi. It becomes one again. It becomes omnipresent, omniconscious, and omnipotent. All the powers and all the joys and all the consciousness become yours. That's samadhi. So the point, actually, we could say the point of life is to return back to where you came from without losing your identity. When you go back to merge with God in samadhi, you still know who you are as a soul. And if you ever want to take a form again, you can take it. But you're now not blocked off from the rest of the truth. In samadhi, everyone is one. You're all the things you look for in life, more happiness, more peace, more wisdom and direction, more energy and strength, more love, all become fulfilled instantly. Do you want that? I tell you what, you don't. I tell you why, because you watch soap operas. In this planet, We have an obsession with things not going right. We actually like it when things are not going right. We're obsessed with them, with the roller coaster. If you offer people sometimes a way out, they'd sit there and go, okay, but it's not exciting. I need some ups and downs. So let me go cause some trouble, then fix it again. Then cause some trouble, then fix it again. Because I like it. It gives me adrenaline rushes. I go up and down, I get really excited. There's a story about a bird in a cage, which I'll tell you about. I think it was something Yogananda said. That if you leave a bird in a cage long enough, and all it knows is that environment, the cage and its little swing and its pecking dish, and then you take the bird in the cage out into the garden and you open the flap, it goes to the edge, it looks out, and it goes back. Even though it has the whole of the freedom of the sky, it goes back to what it knows. It's scared. And I said yesterday, the biggest fear that we have is not that we'll fail, it's that we win. It's that we have power. Because with power comes responsibility, right? And if you've got power, then you have to be responsible for it. It's so much easier to blame other people when things go wrong. I said, well, they had the power. The universe gave me cancer. The doctors messed up my this. The doctors messed up my that. They didn't give me the operation, medication, pollution, whatever, cables in the air, and that's why I'm sick. It's so much easier to blame. But if I said to you, you've got power, fix it, who wants to know? No, it's not my fault, it's not my power. That's what yoga's giving you. It wants to give you power. Open this room. It wants to give you power. Do you want power? Do you want the power to have all the love, all the peace, all the freedom, all the intelligence, all the wisdom, all the happiness? Do you want it? You like the birds in the cage, do you want it? Do you want the power?
Yes.
How interesting, right? Don't want the water? But this is the question. And that's what yoga is saying, is you've got the power of your soul inside you. Do you want to reach it? So yeah, okay. No worries, I'll reach that. Okay, I'll open up the God in me. What do I have to do? You've got to do all these exercises and be disciplined. Yeah, okay, I'll try, I'll give it a go. No, I can't meditate. No, it's all right. I'll switch the TV on and just have dinner. It's not much easier. So one is, do we want the power? Second is, do we want to work for it? We are lazy. We don't want to do all the work and then all the question. So you've got to first get yourself into a position where you want it enough, like you're desperate, and you'll do anything for it. Then you can become a yogi. Okay? Because to be a yogi, you're going to have that dedication, desperation, drive and determination, because you're going to have to push through all your karma. You're going to have to push through all the barriers, all the weak parts of yourself, to push yourself to God. Otherwise, you'll give up halfway down the journey, because you're either lazy or you have a hyperactive mind, which we're very hyperactive in our minds, right? We want next thing. Or we're afraid. So these things we have to deal with to get somewhere, if we want that power. So samadhi is that. The next thing I'll talk about is how India or how yogis evaluate things. So there's this nonsense that goes on in the West called Western science. And it says that if it can't be proved by Western science, it doesn't exist. Try putting love under a microscope. Try putting consciousness under a microscope. Is it there? No, it's not there. Does it exist? Yes. Do you feel it? Yes. Do you use it every day? Yes. So it makes no sense, just on the off. It just makes no sense. It makes no sense to say what you can't see with the five senses doesn't exist. That doesn't make sense, full stop. Okay, so forget about that nonsense. In yoga, if I say to you, I believe in God, and I feel him, and somebody says to me, but he doesn't exist, where is he? Show me him. I'll say, why do I want to show you him? You find him for yourself. I've done all this work finding him. Why don't we show you him? You find him. Okay, so how do I find him? Meditate. There are techniques that you can practice where you can find God inside you. Now, I can't get into you to show you inside your consciousness, so you're going to have to practice it yourself. If you don't want to do it, then stop asking me questions about God. Go and do whatever you want to do with your life. But don't tell me it doesn't exist, because you're too lazy to try and find it. Okay? Now, the laboratory of the yogi is his mind. The laboratory of the Western scientist is a laboratory. They're just different ways of looking at it. So, if you want to find God and you want to feel your soul's power, you have to practice yoga properly and experience it in the laboratory of your consciousness. If you are too lazy or you don't believe, you will not have proof. Done. Now, all you need is the techniques. If you now you go into your consciousness and you find everything, and then you'll know what I'm saying is true. While I'm here, why don't I tell you what it's like to find God? Should I do that? Okay. So, if I meditate and I go into my third eye, if I go into a low state of samadhi and I connect with the spirit, I'm filled. I can describe many, many things to you, but I'll try and keep it simple and concise. But one of the feelings that I have is like all the people that have ever loved me in my life so far, times maybe 10, 100 other lives of people, all loving me at the same time. So when somebody loves you, you feel happy. But imagine if everyone loved you at the same time over many of your lifetimes in one moment. That's what it feels like. You're bursting with joy. Yeah? The nature of God is happiness. The nature of God is not love. God is not love. God is not love. Love is the mechanism that takes us to God. God is Satchitananda, truth, consciousness, and bliss. His nature, the true nature of life is happiness. God's nature is happiness, it's ecstasy, it's ananda, it's joy. So when you meet God, you are raptured with joy. You are so happy inside for no apparent reason, like an idiot smiling to himself. You just sit there in meditation like this, you know? But that's what I feel like. And sometimes being in meditation, and those of you that have meditated, you know, you're sitting there with this big grin on your face, you have no idea why, but you're just so full of joy. It's incredible. And I can't trick my mind into feeling that. I'm not telling myself I'm happy. You can't create that feeling of ecstasy by willpower. You just get taken over by it. Okay? Now I say this to people lots, okay? Is if you are really happy, all your relationships are better. Because you're not asking anymore. You're giving. Right? All you want to do is give the love and the happiness you have. You become such a great person for people to know. People want to be around you. They want to hang out with you. They want to be in relationships with you. They just want a piece of you because you just exude something that they just can't touch. But that's the joy of God inside you. So one of the things, every morning I sit and meditate, I come out happy, so happy. Next thing is peace. No movement in my breath. So something I've been telling people recently a little bit more about is my meditations, which are called breathless meditations. So in this state, my breathing will stop for as long as I want it to. Nowadays, I'm just being completely candid and open with you. Nowadays, it's literally, it seems to be as long as I want. So I tap into my soul, and the breath, respiratory system, ceases. Finish. No breath happening in and out. And I think nowadays it's like 20, 25 minutes sitting in this position. I know my heart rate is going, my body's remaining warm, but my breath is gone, my third eye center is open, and I'm in this space. Now, why is this true? Because I'm now living off my soul. Truth of yoga is this: when you all die, when you all die, you will still be alive. You will have a soul. In yoga, we call it the Atman. It will leave the body and it will ascend. Now, it's not up to me to prove this to you, because if you don't believe it, then you walk away not believing it, and that's okay. My job is to tell you what is yoga, okay? So you're in the Atman and you're alive, but you're alive, but you're not breathing, because the body's on the ground and the breath system is stopped, but you're alive. What I do is I short-circuit everything. And I take myself into a state of death. And I live on my soul. And I just experience the joy of afterlife now. Now, when I do that, I've broken all the bondages that make you come back to this world every time, called reincarnation, because I've liberated myself. So now I'm a liberated person. I don't have to come back here because I've shown that I can do without anything. That's breathless meditation. I'll show you a little bit of that today. But that's where yoga will take you. What else do I feel in this state? Well, I can describe one of God's natures, the most important one probably, as mercy. God is so... I do so many things wrong. I'm littered with mistakes. I'm littered with things that I could be punished for and feel bad or guilty about or be blamed for. I've made so many mistakes in my life. But every time I sit in meditation, my heart is cleaned again. And I'm told where I went wrong. I'm given the wisdom of what I need to do next, but I'm not blamed. There's no anger. Whoever said that God is angry has no idea who he is. Whoever said the wrath of God shall be upon you and makes people feel scared in the churches and in the temples that if you don't do this, you don't do that, or you water your shoe in the temple, or God's going to be after you, or you eat the wrong food, and God is not like that. He's just not like that. God is just not like that. So when you feel him inside you, you feel the amount of... He wraps himself around you and he gives you peace and he teaches you. He's like the perfect mother and father in one. You all need to meet him. If you haven't already, do everything you can to experience him, because I'm telling you, it will make your life completely different. Wisdom. I'm never lost for the next thing to do. Never. Why am I head of an organization and I teach so many people so many things? Because I have so much time to do things like that. Because I'm never confused. I have so much time to help people get their heads straight because I'm all right. If I have a problem, I sit with God. I sit with him and in my meditation, it's all resolved. I have no issues. I have no confusions. I'm as clear as the day. I worry of nothing. I sleep like a baby every night. That's the answer to society. I cure cancer, I sleep all the time. That's half the NHS shut down. I have no digestive issues, why? Because I'm at peace. IBS, colitis, a lot of these conditions you get because the mind is not settled. Mind is overactive, heart is overactive. NHS, shut it down, shut it down. I'm not interested in NHS. We need a new health service. Forget about it. I will take it over and tell them how to run it. Forget about it. I know the answer. It's yoga. Doesn't need anything else. Teach everybody yoga. What? I'm telling you the truth as it is. It can do anything for you. Just connect with your soul. India has given the greatest gift of the world in yoga. You see, the mind only sees the footprints and the fingerprints of life. Doesn't see who made them. Yeah? So when you're stuck in your five senses and you're looking for the answers to life, to what the five senses have showed you, you're just looking at the footprints and the fingerprints. You're not looking at what happened. Only inside your consciousness will you find out the truth. When you go within, you'll find out the truth. And we're coming up to Christmas, and I'm a big follower of Jesus. If I'll be honest with you, Krishna, Jesus, Buddha, everybody. But one thing Jesus said that I always remember is he always said the kingdom of God is within you. Do you remember any of you that phrase? And he was killed for saying things like this, where he shouldn't have been. But what he was basically trying to say is, listen, guys, he also said, I and my Father are one. He knew about the relationship between him and God. He got it right. He knew. He understood. So if you learn to meditate, to calm your mind down, Calm your heart, calm your emotions, calm your senses, and go inside yourself. You'll find that kingdom that Jesus was talking about. You'll find the kingdom the yogis are talking about. Your power is inside you. You just have to make the effort. It's all. Just effort. Now let me tell you something else. There's two ways you find it, discipline or desperation. You feel me? Now? Whenever you've ever gone to anything spiritual, you're either a disciplined person that really knows that they want to learn and they go to the right things and they do the right things, or you're desperate. And something has gone wrong in your life and you need help. Either way are just as good, by the way. I went through desperation. And when I went to God for him to answer and sort himself out and show me, man, I knocked that door hard. I knocked it hard and I knocked it long. He was scared. He was running scared. I answered the door because I wasn't going anywhere fast. I said, I'm staying until I see you. I've got cancer. Sort it out. I don't believe in nothing else. I need you to stop this. And he came. So if you pray or you meditate, you go hard or go home. Like go there properly, like meditate with concentration. Go there with discipline and do it daily. Then you'll get a result. Not before then, not after. A little bit here and there is not going to get you anywhere. As Yogananda says, if you want to fly from New York to LA, flying half the way ain't going to get you there. You've got to fly the whole way. That's why the yoga part is so hard. Because you need to do it fully. So don't follow the footprints. Don't follow the fingerprints of life. Find out who made them. I always say to people, I need to get to my notes. I always say to people, they say, where is God? And I say, the body of God is nature. Yeah? If you want to know where God is, just for starters, the body of God is nature. Just remember that everything in the natural world is his body. And then the rest, the spirit is deeper, but the body of God is nature. That will help you. I'm going to talk a little about some fundamentals now. So I've gone on my little rant. I'm sure that you'll see that again soon. But I'm going to talk about a few of the fundamentals of meditation. For those of you that are new, I mean, this talk today was going to be deep anyway because I wanted to go straight for Christmas. But I'm going to talk about some fundamentals. For those of you who've never meditated, maybe bring a pen and a pad with you or something small to write on. You're welcome to use your phone. So the first thing is times to meditate. When is the best time to meditate? This is a very interesting answer I'm going to give you because I've studied meditation. I've been to some of the best schools in India and in the UK of meditation with some of the greatest gurus. And my conclusion is the best time to meditate is?
Anytime.
5 to 7.
Anytime.
Okay. So look, in truth, the early morning is the best time. Just because the atmosphere, the energy is calmer, more settled, it's quieter outside. You've got a little bit of that dusk phase between the moon and the sun. It's a very beautiful time to meditate. But I'm going to say this. The best time to meditate is when you have shown concentration, depth, dedication, devotion, and discipline. Whatever time of the day it is, you need to be concentrating. It is the depth and not the length of meditation that matters. Okay? It's the depth, not the length. So it doesn't matter how long you meditate for, it matters how well, how deep you are meditating. I know some people that go to meditation schools and class and they sit there for 3 hours and they come out and they're exactly the same as they came in. Exactly the same. And I know because I come out and they go, so how's that for you? What should we have for dinner? Let's get some food. I'm like, you've been sitting there for 3 hours doing what? Thinking about what we're going to eat. Go back, do another 5 minutes with concentration, then we'll talk. I come out sometimes with 5 minutes of meditation and I'm sent elsewhere. I am all over the place because my mind is just with him because I'm deep. I go in with determination, with depth. I fight my way in there, I fight my conscience, and I meditate deep. Then it doesn't matter how long. Because in the world of God, there is no time, there is no space. There are no atoms and there are no vibrations. There's nothing of these. You go deep, in seconds, you're with God. It's not a show-off thing. I meditate for 3 hours, 2 hours, 1 hour, 7 day, this, that. Who cares? I don't care. Your timing is not what God works in anyway. You meditate deep. Doesn't have to be long. Deep. My meditations every morning are 15 minutes to half an hour. That's all. Often, I can sit for 10 minutes and I'm fine for the entire day. Because I don't waste time there. You know? You're not wasting time in meditation. Sit there and be determined to go deep. Like, go like a warrior into your meditation. I'm going to sit and I'm going to find God today. My breath is going to still. My mind is going to still. My emotions are going to still. And I am going to find you today. With the power of a warrior. You go in and you find it and you come out. You have to be strong to be a yogi. You have to be powerful of mind. No, none of this lotus flowers and incense. Sit down and meditate. In the West, even in India, too much of it is paraphernalia, cultural, aesthetic. Forget about it. If you're a yogi, you'll sit anywhere and find God. Challenge yourself to be strong-minded. Don't flatter yourselves. Don't flatter a yogi. I don't dress in yogi robes. They're as deep as anyone. So be a practical Western yogi. Sit down wherever you are. Meditate any time of day and be determined to be at one with your soul. You can do it. You will do it. Anytime. Never be afraid. Don't be bullied by time. But as many of you are saying, mornings is personally my favorite time to meditate, and before breakfast. So not with food in the stomach. After wash, sit down, do your morning meditation. Please, every day is the best time, if possible, as well as additional time, and then start your day. I always say to people, in a civilized society, we would wash our minds like we wash our mouths and our body before we meet people. In a dirty world, we dump whatever's in here on everybody. If you've got the culture to brush your teeth before you speak to someone, wash your mind before you speak to them too. So morning meditation. Be decent to people. Don't just start your day opening your mouth saying anything that falls out of it. That's what we do. Like, think about society. That's what I'm saying. Think about it. Be cultured. Be civilized. I tell people my office where I work doesn't open till 11. I don't want to talk to people before 11. My staff stay at home. I tell them, meditate before you come and talk to me. I'll meditate before I talk to you. We should all start our days meditate. Extra 2 hours less working, making money, right? But meditate will be a better society. But they get you into work. Sometimes if you're working in a certain industry, 8 o'clock in the morning, you're there till 7 at night, thrashing, beating you up until you make as much money for the company as possible, and throw you out and get the next upstart in. It's a horrible society. Like, don't do it. Don't do it. You'll be resourceful enough to find a way. I promise you, you'll find a way. But live the correct way. Meditate in the mornings. Look after yourselves. Don't be bullied by this. Don't be bullied. No matter what, don't be bullied by this world. It only wants your money. Where to meditate? Where to meditate? So again, it's a similar thing. If you are a strong yogi, you meditate anywhere. But if you have the same spot to meditate every day, it builds a vibration. So if you have like an altar in your house, one little picture of your guru or a candle or something, and if you go there regularly, daily, it builds up a vibration over time and it becomes a good place to meditate. So it's nice to do meditation in the same spot every day. But again, we live in a practical world. I want you to be strong enough to meditate anywhere. This is the challenge. Meditate anywhere. Where you go, bring God to you. He is everywhere anyway. The soul is inside you anyway. Bring it all to you. Don't be afraid to ask. Don't be afraid to do great things. So anywhere. And by the way, I'm not against religious institutions at all, because, you know, a lot of people who go to pray at temples and mosques and churches, it's great because it builds up an atmosphere and a vibration in that place. And you feel it when you go in. And also helps people that are not strong. When they go there, they get lifted. So sometimes it's good to meditate and take it to a chapel or take it to a temple and do your meditation there, because it helps others also. It's that giving of yourself. I approve of that. How regularly to meditate? Look, I meditate once in the morning and once in the night time, shortly, for a short time. And once a week I meditate for a couple of hours in my center I go to. So I would say every day, 15 minutes, this is a minimum standard. Every day, 15 minutes in the morning, once a week, long. Find one period of time in the week to sit to meditate for a couple of hours. But otherwise, every day meditate for 15 minutes. When you become a yogi, you don't meditate when you feel like it. Meditation has nothing to do with your feelings. Meditation is your discipline. It's what you do. If you brush your teeth, you meditate. It's like that. You don't brush your teeth if you're not in a good mood, do you? Or do you? I hope you brush your teeth even if you're not feeling happy. The same with the mind. Don't look at the difference between the teeth and the mind and you'll be fine. Mind, teeth, body, wash, everything, start your day. Make it your way. Make it your way. Don't have any other way. Can you eat and meditate? No. You have one power in your body. Okay? Your shaktis in your body, the five pranas. So when it's meditation time, your energy goes to your third eye chakra. It goes to the higher centers. And the digestive chakra switch off, become lower. Now if you've eaten, they will all the food in your stomach will ferment. And then your colon will stop the traffic. And you get a traffic jam. Yeah? And then you have trouble pushing past that in the morning, next morning. So you need to finish your digestion, almost empty stomach, and meditate. I like to always meditate on an empty stomach. My suggestion, empty stomach. No food, not anything, not even water. Sip of water only. Sip. Some yoga classes you go to, they won't even let you drink water around that time. So sip if you need, and then sit to meditate. And then your body is very quiet. It's got nothing to do but focus on you. So we're going to get on to a few of the secrets now. So this talk was entitled something Secrets of Meditation. What was it called? Unlocking the Secrets of Meditation. So the first thing I'm going to tell you, really important part, and now this is where I'm going to get deep. When you are meditating, or when you are praying to a part of yourself. Okay? So, our seventh chakra always holds God within us. Right? This is the story. When God decided to make all of us, he broke us into little fragments. He retained himself in his place, and he broke us into little fragments, and he put us down in something called creation, which was covered by like a veil, and underneath it everything was filled with time, space, atoms, and so on and so forth. But when he made this place, he put himself in there as his children. Okay? But being his children, we are exactly the same as he is. Now, as we're in this veil, and we're covered in this veil called Maya, which is like our body, we retain a little part of him, and that's in our seventh chakra. Okay? So when you pray to God, what are you praying to? If you are him in creation, what are you praying to? You're praying to yourself. And that sounds terribly blasphemous. But all I'm saying to you is, if samadhi is union with God again, and samadhi is getting rid of the space between you and God, then every time you pray to a distant God, you're making the space bigger. Now I'm saying this, these are deep secrets of meditation. This is why it may not make sense to you today. But you have to pull away the part of you that thinks God is separate to you, even when you're praying. Are we going to practice in a minute? So you literally are going to feel like not only are you praying to yourself, but you're fulfilling your prayers. you understand? It's like if I'm saying to myself, I need to cure this cancer, I'm fulfilling it at the same time. If you're saying to yourself, I need to find peace, you're fulfilling, you're able to fulfill it at the same time because he's sitting inside you. You have enough oil inside you to do it. So when you pray, when we do it soon, you sit down and you imagine that you're praying to your higher chakra and your higher chakra is able to respond back to you, like it's all in you. And then you're going to have this amazing realization that it's all inside you. The power, the love, and the God, as one aspect of himself, is sitting inside you. You can reach that. In yoga, we call three things Om, Sat, and Tat. Okay? Om, Sat, and Tat. Now, Sat is the God outside of creation, the one that created us to come down here. Tat are the pieces in creation, the souls, made of the same thing. And the Om is the Maya, is the generator, the one who has the power over Maya, that helped to make it, the vibration, the cosmic vibration. It separates and also links the Sat and the Tat. So when you appeal to your inner self, you're appealing to the Tat, the God in creation. And you can reach that and feel all the powers and everything that I described to you while you're in creation. And then, when you've appealed to Tat and you've become one with your soul through yoga, you can then take Tat back to meet Sat and make Samadhi. All right? But for the first instant, you are not Maya, you are Tat. You are God in creation. Then take Tat to Sat in Samadhi. You have everything inside you. So when you pray, we have this image and this way of praying. We are here and God is somewhere there. And we're reaching out to try to find something there. Pray, I'm down here, please do something for me down here. What I'm saying to you is, when you ask of God and you pray, remember he is right inside you, and you take that film away and you feel like you're praying to yourself, and you can fulfill yourself too. All the power lies in you. And what did I say earlier? That's one of the scariest things, to know how powerful you are, because it means you've got to work and you've got to be responsible. That's the first secret, is get it. Try slowly. I know it's going to be difficult for some of you to get this concept of it being not being outside you. But this is my first secret. It's like a tiny film. Imagine like you've got God, you've got this energy here, God energy, and there's like a little film that's slot in between. Yeah? Something slotting in between, separating you two. Separating. And you just pull that film out. And suddenly the Tat meets the Sat and you're one. That's the power. And then you are complete. That's your shortcut to a finality of yoga. You start doing clever things like this. Pull out the separation in your mind. Pull it away. You don't need it. Merge inside yourself. God says, don't pray to me, my child, be me. Be love. Don't pray to me, be me. Don't pray to me, be me. If you have a child and your child is always saying to you, Dad, can you do this for me? Dad, can you do that for me? Dad, do this for me. Dad. Eventually, Dad is going to say to the son, stop asking me to do things for you, be me. The child's like, what do you mean be? He says, grow. Be what I am and more. What he's saying, the same thing to you. He's saying, be me. Stop thinking of yourself as little man down here. And start exhibiting some of my qualities. Be me. Yeah? I've written something down here. Praying to God as if he was separate from yourself. It's like talking to your mirror and thinking it's somebody else. You're talking to a mirror and you think that's somebody else, that's just crazy. as praying to God and think it's somebody else. It's all you. Let's do a little meditation now for a few moments. So I want you to just take a comfortable position. We're going to do this little prayer thing for 5 minutes only. I'm not expecting a lot out of you. When you sit to meditate on chairs, sit on the edge of your chair. I'll give you a little example. Yeah. Rima will give you an example if she jumps up quickly for me. Whenever you sit to meditate on a chair, and I'll go through this with you for a couple of minutes now, you always sit on the edge of the chair and make sure your feet are flat on the ground and your spine is straight. And keep the hands, palms turned up onto the lap. And the most important part of meditation is keeping the spine straight. So she can keep the chest a little forward and the shoulders a bit pulled back, and then keeping the chin parallel to the ground. Can you see her chin? Can you see her chin? Keep the chin parallel to the ground, and then the eyes will gently close there. And that's fine for you all to try to sit like now. So if you can shuffle up to the edge of your chair. As you can see with the Rima sitting, chest forward a little bit, shoulders a bit pulled back, palms of the hands turned up towards the ceiling, chin parallel to the ground, and then gently allow your eyelids to close. Just for a couple of moments, center your attention to your breath, because it's the first time we're meditating today. Take your attention down to your breath. Just feel your breath within for a second. And we're going to go straight into the technique. So imagine, and if you don't normally pray, that's fine. You can just sit quietly in your mind, or you can pray for the first time today. Imagine you were praying to God for something, like for the health of your partner or something else. And you were just talking to God and praying. And you saw God as being above where you're sitting praying from, maybe the top of your mind or above your head, and you are where you are. But there's some type of separation between you two. You see a separation between you two, maybe meeting, but separate. And I want you to imagine a thin film, like a thin plastic film, separating the lower you and this higher you, God. And it separates you at the moment. And you're praying upwards towards this force. Now what I want you to do, hopefully you've got a good imagination, is imagine with your fingers, you're slowly pulling that film away that separates what you conceive to be yourself and what you conceive to be the separate God. Imagine you're pulling it away, and slowly, weirdly, the two things are commingling. The you part that's praying and the part that's being prayed to are starting to merge into one form. Slowly pull that film away and allow this merging to happen. And you're feeling like you're connecting with God. Your lower self is rising up, and he is coming down, and you pull this film almost completely away, and then see what you feel. Just sit for a few moments. Prayer. Prayer becomes a prayer too. Now imagine you're listening to your own prayers and bestowing your own blessings on yourself. Try that. You've heard your own prayers, and now you're blessing yourself and bestowing the answers to yourself. Imagine like a river meeting an ocean separated by a dam, and you've taken the dam down and the ocean is becoming one. It's just like Jesus said, I and my Father are one. Just practice for another minute. Just make a note of that technique in your mind or whatever you want. And if you practice regularly like that, your meditations will grow and grow, and your depth will deepen and deepen and deepen. By the way, I think what we'll do is if everyone leaves their email address before they leave, we'll send out the techniques. We'll write them out and send them to you in case you need to have a reminder. So that is merging yourself with God, very simply by putting the distance away. Thank you. So that is your first secret today, is speed up that process of samadhi, speed up that process of union by taking that concept. All that thin film was that I created in your mind was a concept. It was a maya that I pulled away from you. Om Sat and Tat. The only thing that separates you from the source is this little game that's being played. And it's only played in your mind. And as soon as you take your mind out of that game, you will connect back to where you came from. At the moment, you don't know, you weren't supposed to know. But now, you have to be known. So you put it away. The more you repeat to yourself that He is there, and I am here, and God is perfect, and I'm a loser, and I need to keep asking, the more trouble you're going to be in. That's not the way to pray anymore. Olden days. Now you go and find Him with all your might and all your intelligence. He gave you a brain to use. So use it. Take it away. No more maya. Not in your meditation. We're going to do a Q&A at the end as well. So if you have any questions or anything, you can go through it. A second part I'll tell you about, the second secret. Now, I say the reason I call them secrets is because when people focus on meditation, they focus on lovely techniques, lovely music, lovely teachers' clothes, lovely petals, lovely incense, lovely pictures of God. It's all nonsense. You don't need any of it. It's dross. Techniques will get you nowhere unless you have the correct attitude. So this first attitude I showed you is release maya. The second attitude is going to be surrender. Simple surrender. Let go. I'll say this. The greatest action is non-action, no action. The greatest action in yoga and meditation is no action. The greatest action is relaxation. The greatest action is no action, is relaxation. Relax who you are. The minute you start taking this stupid monkey mind into meditation, you're finished. Because this digital mind that we have says, right, I've done X, Y, and Z, I'll get X, Y, and Z result. Oh, I haven't got that result, I've failed. Let me change the figure, I'll get that, I'll do that. Okay, I've done that longer, so I should get that. Oh, I have all these expectations, I haven't fulfilled them, I must be a loser, I'm going back to square one. I'll start again, but harder. I'm pushing harder now. Normally, if I do things harder and longer, I get better. I'm doing them harder and longer, I'm not getting better, I'm going back to square one. That's why we don't make it in meditation. We just go crazy. The mind can't travel in meditation. Just like a UFO can't, or a spaceship or a plane can't go through a black hole. Certain things don't go certain places. Your mind cannot go into meditation. Your mind has to be off. That's why I say the greatest action in meditation is not techniques, it's non-action, it's surrender. You let go to let it come. No one will teach you this. Let it go. Surrender completely. I was telling people the other day this, and I wrote something on my Facebook page. There's something I wrote years ago. If you've ever loved, you've always fallen. You fall in love. You don't hurdle to God, you surrender. You don't force meditation, you relax. All of the greatest things that we do in our life that bring us the greatest satisfaction and happiness, we have to relax for. Even taking a shit. You try going toilet stressed. And isn't going to toilet the most best pleasure you have? Or is it eating? What do you think is more enjoyable? Put your hands up if it's eating. There you go. And who going to toilet? Put your hand up. If going to toilet is more pleasure. Okay, let's say we do like this. I go and cook the most, or I prepare the most amazing dinner for you all. You sit there, it's like seven courses, dinners, dessert, everything, and you eat it and you love it and you enjoy it. Fantastic. You come back 6 hours later, I've got lunch ready. It's a fantastic spread. You enjoy it, you love it, it's beautiful. Dinner time comes, another meal, fantastic, you enjoy it. Next day you wake up, you're gonna go sit down. Nothing's happening. Do you want breakfast? Yeah, okay, I'll have a little bit of breakfast. By the fifth meal, all you want to do is shit. But you can't. Now imagine that that was taken away from you, that you were so stressed, you couldn't relax to go. Food would mean nothing to you. Now you understand the pleasure of relaxation. Your autonomic nervous system only works when you're relaxed, right? So food is nothing to us. What we take in is nothing. It's what we let go that makes our lives happy. Okay? So, same principle with meditation. Let it go, relax, and everything will come. Surrender yourself. You must have no desire for results in meditation. So again, another very puzzling thing for the human mind. You must go in there expecting nothing. Nothing. You sit to meditate. God, you come when you're ready. I'm not going anywhere. I'll be here daily, knocking this door, but you don't have to answer it. He'll get puzzled. You get puzzled. He understands humans because they knock and then they get disappointed and they run back and he's like, God, this one again. Right? But I sit there, I say, I'm going to sit down next to the door of heaven like this and I'm going to knock with absolute concentration and I'm not going anywhere. If you want to answer the door, answer. If you don't, that's fine. I'm going to be here every day anyway. I'm here anyway. I sit whenever happens, happens. Then he looks out of his people. Who's this one? He's sitting here meditating, keeps knocking, he doesn't want me to open the door. He's going to open the door. Just out of curiosity alone. So, but again, what I'm talking about is quite serious, is that it's that human mind aspect. I want something, I want a result, I expect a result, why haven't I got a result? Is it me? Around and round and round and round. And God's just watching you like a mouse going around in the world thinking, that one again. Go there, opposite. Surrender, say, it doesn't matter when you come, when you don't come. I've got all the time in the world. I am patient. Oh, patience. Oh. Okay, so let me tell you about patience. There are 14 levels to our universe, 14 swargas, 14 different types of universe, okay? 14 different ones. We're on the seventh one. In Sanskrit, it's known as Buloka, the realm of... It's kind of half heaven, half hell. That's why we're quite mixed here. But there are six levels above us. And the top level is called Satyaloka, the realm of God. The level below that is called Tapaloka. Right? And Tapaloka is defined as the realm of eternal patience. So my point is this. Just before any of you even think about connecting to your soul or God, if you haven't mastered patience, you ain't going to get there. You just are not getting there. So in any area of your life where you can keep practicing how good you are at patience, practice it. It's one of those golden tickets that they won't teach you in meditation because there's no technique for patience. You either got it or you don't. It's one of the things that I pride myself on is patience. I'm a very patient guy. I've got time. I can see things through. I'm slow. Because that's what I know, that's my skill that's going to get me to my soul. I will never mess with my patience. Yeah? So, patience. Let the ego go with no expectations. Let's sit up and practice that now. Sit in your meditation position. Let's do a surrendering meditation. This is so simple. Sit with the spine straight. Keep your eyes closed, palms of the hands turned up towards the ceiling. Take your attention to your breath for a few moments. Just feel the breath inside the body. Now imagine we've done the meditation before, when you're sitting there and you're taking away that distance between yourself and God, that little film that separates you from the spirit. You're putting it away. And it's almost like we can use the metaphor we just used. Imagine you've gone to the doors of heaven, for want of a better expression. You're sitting on the doors of God, whoever you want to see him. And you're meditating with discipline, with calmness, with control. And you're telling God you love him and that you're there and that you're happy to merge with this power, but you're not in a rush. I'm going to love you anyway. I'll sit patiently and wait and surrender. Do this for a minute. No expectations, yeah? Just sit. You're just whispering, come when you're ready. Whenever you're ready, I'm here. Surrender. Try to let go at levels you've never let go of before. Just let go. Like your name, your status, everything. Just let everything go. And just sit in prayer, sit in meditation. Just for a minute. Take your mind in there. So remember what you're doing. And then you practice it in your meditations on this feeling of letting go, surrendering. Slowly allow your eyes to open again. Final part I would describe as service. Final secret is service. First thing I've got written down here is that God is in your soul is not accessed by strong, powerful minds, but it's accessed by crystal clear hearts. You have to go in with a lot of devotion. You've got to go in not looking for something. It's the first relationship you may have where you don't need and want anything back and that you're not demanding anything. You're going there to love. You're going there to unite. So when you approach your meditations, don't feel like you want anything back, but go there just simply to give of yourself. Imagine it's like your karma yoga. You know what karma yoga is? Most of you should know if you're here. Your service. Have you ever approached a meditation like that? Approach it as your service. It's your duty. Not always asking for something, but there to give something back, to serve. It's your bhakti yoga. It's your devotional yoga. It's to give respects and devotion back. Now, one of the most important things that we find in our lives is that people that love us are irresistible. Don't you find that? When somebody loves you, it's really hard to not love them back. Especially enemies. Especially when somebody's done you wrong, or that you think that they should be upset, angry at you, and they're showing you love, it's really baffling. It's like, can you just not hate me? And they're like, no, oh, come on, give me a hug. Oh my God, you're so good at this. Mm-hmm. You know? Same thing with God. He melts when you, if you want to succeed in meditation, you must go in with service. Service for latitude. You must go there to give. Not to take, but to give. It's greater than any other technique that you'll learn in meditation is the technique of service. To go and give something. What can I do for you? What love can I show to you? What do you want from me? He'll say nothing but your time and your love. Now, the only reason God created us, there's only one main reason. Because before he was one whole, one thing he couldn't feel is love, because he was all encompassed, happiness, truth, wisdom, peace, God was everything. But the one thing he couldn't feel was love, because he was one. And love is the force of unification, the joy of finding somebody again. So he separated himself into a few parts, and he put himself in this veil. And he played hide and seek, spiritual hide and seek. And said, well, I'm going to hide over here, leave them some clues, and let's find each other. And that's what is, that's the whole description of life there. Because then when we find him, and we show love, and we get to him, and we unify, everybody's happy. It's like they all throw a party in heaven because one soul has been found. That's what it's like. So if you go with devotion and love, he can feel you, and he'll start opening the pathway and say, oh, he's nearly found me. And he'll open the doors and come. Love God, it's irresistible to him. Just like it is with other people. Don't be mad at God. God didn't do nothing. It's us. So, devotion. Always have devotion in your heart. If you can't find God in your heart, you'll never find him outside it. If you can't find him inside your heart, you're not going to find him anywhere else. You've got to go inside and find him. You've got to feel him. So invite him into your heart. Invite him into your temple. Let him come to you. But nowhere else will he be. He won't be in a book, he won't be in anyone's words, and he won't be in a temple. He'll be inside you or nowhere else. For that, to draw him in, devotion. I say this, only when you love God more than anyone else can you truly be happy. Unless you have peace within yourself, with God and your soul, that's the time you can only truly be happy. Because otherwise you're searching for scrapings of love from people, or from experiences, or from the job, or something else. And you'll find bits and pieces everywhere. And you'll find them for short amounts of time. But when you've got this place inside yourself that you can go to reliably every day, and you feel something, not just in your imagination or scriptures, but you feel him, then you'll be truly happy, because your happiness will never be taken away after that. That was the purpose, was finding him. The purpose was finding him. When you achieve that purpose, you're fine. He's your God, he's your mother, he's your father. The original. Your father and your mother on this planet were given to you as custodians for a short time only, but they were not your parents. They looked after you. They were your brother and sister souls on the same journey as you. But they go, isn't it? Then what do? Now you have to find the real parent, the real source of yourself. And that's what meditation will show you. You ready to do a little bit more meditation? A few more minutes, and then we'll do a Q&A, and we'll nearly be done then. So, if you come to the edge of the chair, can I have my assistant, please? So we're going to do three techniques. The first technique, very, very, very simply shown, is a breathing technique called Trinity Breath, and it's going to be you breathing in for 3 seconds, holding the breath for 3 seconds, and exhaling for 3 seconds. It just helps to calm the mind and to be simple. After that, we're going to do something called Om Shanti, which is to settle your breath down completely, and then finally, we'll do a Maha Mantra. a maha mantra together before we finish. So with Trinity breath, she's going to keep the hands, palms turned up onto the knees. And she's going to breathe in for 3 seconds. So breathing into the chest. 1, 2, 3. And holding the breath. 1, 2, 3. And exhaling the breath. 1, 2, 3. And again, one more time. Breathing in slowly. 2, 3. And hold. 1, 2, 3. And slowly exhale. 1, 2, 3. So we're all going to practice that together now. So if you're ready, and I'll take you through the techniques. So breathing in slowly, everybody. 1, 2, 3, and hold. 1, 2, 3. Exhale slowly. 1, 2, 3. Keep your spine straight. Breathing in. 1, 2, 3, and hold. 1, 2, 3, and exhaling. 1, 2, 3. Breathing in slowly. 1, 2, 3, and hold. Keep your concentration. 2, 3, and exhaling. 1, 2, 3. Keep your spine straight. Breathing in again. 1, 2, 3, and hold. 1, 2, 3, and exhaling. 1, 2. Keep your eyes closed, let your breathing return to normal. Keep your spine straight. Some of you, if you've never done this before, will be feeling a little sleepy, but keep your concentration. What I want you to do now is to observe the natural flow of breath inside your body. So this is no more deep breathing, but just watch your breathing pattern as it naturally happens. And every time a breath enters your body, mentally say the word Om, just quickly like that, Om, when a breath enters, just in your mind, not aloud, in your mind. And when a breath leaves the body, mentally say the word Shanti. So every time breath comes in, saying Om, when it leaves, saying Shanti. And allow the breath to be quite spaced apart if it wants to. Don't force the breath to come in. Let it happen at its own pace. Observe your breath. Don't adjust it or change it. Keep your chin parallel to the ground, your spine straight. Keep your concentration. When breath comes in, mentally saying the word Om. When it leaves, mentally saying the word Shanti. Keep your concentration. You'll start to observe that your breath is calmer in your body. Keep it that way. If you practice this technique for long enough, with sincerity, the breath will completely disappear by itself, and you'll be in that soul realm. Very simple. Whenever a breath comes in, don't rush it, don't force it, don't expect it, keep the mind out of it. You say the word Om. And whenever it leaves, say the word Shanti, but keep your mind away. Keeping your spine straight, very calmly and gently allow your eyelids to raise again. Keep your body still if you can for a few moments, see how you feel. So those two techniques are to help calm the breath to help calm the nervous system and to slowly help to calm the mind. Like I said, one of the prerequisites of success in meditation is first to get the mind under control. If you don't do that, you'll take the wrong attitude in. We're going to do an affirmation now, which in Chikku Yoga we call the Maha Mantra. Very powerful, which we'll practice 6 times, very simple. And the words are this: no body, no mind, no breath have I. I am love, I am peace, I am bliss. That's all. And every time you say those words, feel them. Like, you're not a body, you're not a mind, you're not a breath system, but what you are is pure love, peace, and bliss. Now let's practice together. Keep the eyes closed again. And repeat with me. No body, no mind, no breath have I. I am love, I am peace, I am bliss. Feel it when you say it. No body, no mind, no breath have I. I am love, I am peace, I am bliss. Feel those words. No body, no mind, no breath have I. I am love, I am peace, I am bliss. No body, no mind, no breath have I. I am love, I am peace, I am bliss. No body, no mind, no breath have I. I am love, I am peace, I am bliss. Just a whisper now. Feel yourself not as a human being, but as a soul. Be light. Slowly and carefully allow your consciousness to come back to the room, allow your eyes to open. These techniques you can practice regularly and for longer. It will take you deeper, deeper into meditation with the right attitude. Like I said, I'll get all these techniques out to you today, just getting a taste of what you can do. We're going to open the floor now. Is there a second mic for questions? No, you don't have to open the light yet. So we've got a few moments just to answer some questions on meditation. So if anybody has any, we'll see if we can... Oh, there's just one. Okay, yes, gentlemen.
If one has a weak back, can we lean on the wall and not, if we are not
good
able
question.
To keep the spine straight?
Thank you. So with meditation, generally, keeping the spine straight is the most important thing because we need to wake up the chakras and keep it going. Now, if your back is a little bit weak, then of course you can lean up against something, but be careful that you don't fall asleep against that wall. That's the only thing you have to watch for. When we sit and we relax in meditation, that you don't find yourself too comfortable. But otherwise, if that's your option, and that it supports your back, then for sure, you can do that.
And when you breathe out, do you have to breathe out through your nose or through your mouth?
Most of the time, it depends on the technique itself, but I pray that through either. It's not so important. It depends what technique it is. If we were doing the Trinity breath, normally I'd use the nose. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Thank you very much for such a wonderful talk.
Well,
I'll give you my background. I was born and brought up in India in a Hindu Brahmin family.
Let's get a microphone to him, somebody.
So I did all these...
Let's go around with the mic.
Hope you don't mind if I ask you direct questions.
Yeah, please, but take it with the mic.
Hello, can you hear me?
I can.
Thank you very much for such a wonderful talk. I'm quite impressed. My background is that I was born and brought up in a Hindu Brahmin family where my grandmother and mother used to do all the meditation. Then, luckily or unluckily, I became a doctor, came to this country, and I practiced 22 years as a surgeon, and I'm fully trained. Coming to sarcoma, if you tell the doctors here, they will tell you either your diagnosis is wrong or you're telling the lies. Number one. Number two, when you come to the specialty, I became a GP for the family region and I'm nearly 69, I'm just retiring, I'm still working 3 days a week. Ask your people from the Lord, who are the Lord, what is the protocol of dying patients? We call it palliative care.
Yes.
I have seen at least well over 1,000 patients. I look after them when they are dying and what we do, just give them morphine to kill them. But we never talk about, and in the beginning, I'm talking about...
Can I just say something? What's very interesting is, I'm in an all-party parliamentary group at the House of Lords discussing what the NICE guidelines have just done, is they've taken yoga off palliative care.
That's true, I follow the NICE.
Why did they do that?
Because it is Hindu, and, and there are a lot of complaints. I have dealt with the Hindu, Muslim, Sikhs, Evangelical, Catholic, Protestant, and sometimes Jews. And sometimes they become very, very abruptive. So we do not talk about anything, we just do the morphine, dimorphine, and all these, and kill them.
Well, have you got a question now?
No, so can I help you to bring these things?
Definitely, you can definitely help. Speak to my staff afterwards, and we'll definitely work together on something.
Thank you.
Thank you. Take the mic and pass it to the next person over here.
I have just one simple question. Do we have to think of anything while you are doing this yoga?
Focus the mind.
On what?
On, if you focus the mind on the third eye center, or you focus the mind on what you consider to be God, or your guru, or the spirit, or the universe, if you keep your mind focused on a good positive source, then do your breathing and everything else, that's good. Actually, it's not good to keep the mind totally unfocused. It needs to be have some point of concentration to begin with. But don't let it waver around. Next question. Pass the microphone back. Rima, look after the mic. Somebody else over here. I'll pass it that way quickly, guys.
From your experience of new students, myself could be potentially a new student, but I've never done yoga before. And assuming that I heed your advice to put a lot of effort into it and not give up easily. What sort of time scale and level of commitment do you think I should prepare myself for?
I think a reasonable start, it's different for everybody of course, but a reasonable start would be, like I said, just 15 minutes in the morning of meditation and starting like one or two yoga classes a week. If you're completely new, getting involved with the asana, which would introduce you to the deeper sides. And pick up a good yoga book like Autobiography of a Yogi and read it regularly, and then let's see how you are in 6 months after that time.
6 months. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Next question.
You just showed us the three Trinity breaths, the mantra and the Om Shanti. I just wanted to know, so do you say Om Shanti? Do you say the mantra? Because it's all at the same time.
So what is happening is whenever breath enters, when you're doing the Om Shanti technique, whenever breath naturally enters your body, yeah, you just mentally say the word Om. And then whenever the breath naturally leaves the body, you say the word Shanti. And then when it re-enters again, you just say the word Om. And when it leaves, Shanti, that's it.
So that's a different technique from, and when do you say the mantra then?
Well, you can do these things at separate occasions. You don't have to do them in the order. Why I've done the mantra today was just to tell you guys a mantra that you can do. But I'll send them all out to you if I get what your email address is. Next question. Behind you. I've got two more minutes.
What's the purpose of life? What's the purpose of living?
The purpose of life is that the point of life is to find the point of life. That's why we came here, to get out.
You just find the love. That's it.
Sorry?
You just find the love.
Find love. The purpose of life is to come out of where we are lost from.
I love everybody.
Good. Well, you've got the right purpose. Anyone else? At the back, gentleman in the back with the green jumper.
I was just wondering why you have to have your palms facing upwards and why you don't have them in a different position.
One of the reasons why the palms are facing upwards is because what we're trying to do in meditation is to relax all the senses. So most of them we can control by closing the eyes, not eating at the same time, not smelling, so on and so forth. And we have a lot of our sensory attention invested in our hands. So when you turn them up, it kind of signals to the hands that they're switched off and also they're not touching anything and sending any sensations back. It's also a nice gesture for receiving energy as well.
But if I tend to meditate with my hands on my knees, kind of pointing down, and I find relaxation, is that fine to continue?
If you ever find that your meditations need to go further, that's maybe one thing you can adjust.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Why do you refer to God as He?
God is both. But sometimes we can look at a male form and a female form. The male form of God is, I mean, this is a long conversation, but the male form is truth, and the female form is known as compassion and creativity. But obviously it's one form. So sometimes they refer to it as God, sometimes as she, sometimes as a he. But it doesn't mean that God is a he. Yes. At the back?
Very effortless to have single concentration now in the group. When I'm doing it on my own, how am I going to...
So he's saying it's effortless to have single-minded concentration in a group, but on your own you have to imagine I'm in your head. I'm not even joking. I hear my guru's voice. And my mother was a yoga teacher. I hear their voices in my head that barks at me to concentrate. This is why we have yoga teachers, because they teach you to be strong. And eventually their teachings and their methods become yours. Thank you guys for coming. Oh, is it very quick one?
Just very quick one.
Yeah.
If you're a religious person and if you have your rituals, yes, should you do the meditation
before? If you're a religious person and you have rituals, you do your prayers and everything, do your meditation before, because it will make you more concentrated, and then your prayers and your practices will go better.
Thank
you. Guys, just a few notices before we close up. First of all, from my heart to yours, thank you so much for sitting there and listening to my conversation today. I appreciate that I'm very forthright with things, but hopefully I get things over through to you quicker. And also, if you like it or don't like it, you can make up your mind quickly. There's no ambiguity in me. You know where I stand, and that's important. Otherwise, I think that's it, right? Thank you so much, guys. I love you all. Thank you for coming. Have a wonderful discussion. I want to keep going. Well, thank you.
It was very motivational, it was very inspiring. I think Neil made me a lot more calmer.
Yeah, I've meditated before, but short periods of time usually.
Before meditation, it's actually very important to calm down, because I don't do that regularly.
Okay.
So that's actually one thing I can do now before I start my yoga.
Oh yeah, I found that a really, really amazing talk. It was a lot of useful information, and meditation techniques were amazing. Really helped to clear my mind. The highlight, definitely what Neil's wise words when he was saying about experience with samadhi, because that really resonated with me. I mean, it's something that I've been very curious to find out more about it and what it actually is. And yeah, just to hear someone who's actually experienced it, it's amazing to be in the presence of it.